The crossing analyses of the IT industry and international relations. Welcome to the revamped edition of the Tech Geopolitics Unveiled. I'm Rocky Uriankai. Today we're analysing a rumour that hasn't happened yet, but has been widely reported, which is China's Huawei is about to launch its new smartphones. Why this rumour is worth following is because Huawei was forced to quit the smartphone market after the US further tightened its sanctions on the Chinese brand in May 2020, causing the company to have trouble obtaining handset chips, and it even sold its sub-brand Honor. If the company is really making a comeback to the smartphone market, does it have the advanced chips it needs now? Who is designing them for the brand? Who is making them? If they are all local companies, then we were obviously wrong when we cited Richard Chang's statement that China is currently trying to conquer the issue of acquiring lithography machines for the 28-nanometer node during the previous episode. So has China finally made a breakthrough in this chip war that it has been suppressed all along the way? Before we officially start, let's take a moment for our promotional services. Taiwan is a global hub for the development of the IT industry, with topics from semiconductors to electronics all attracting global attention. But how do we grasp onto the future of development trends? DIGITIMES e-learning platform is the only online training brand that focuses primarily on technology trends, provided by DIGITIMES analyst team and industry experts. Industry knowledge essential to subscribing audiences and hot topics of the 9 major IT industries can all be learned at any time and any place via over 100 online videos and advisors. Check out the description section below the video for more information on DIGITIMES e-learning platform. Let's get to the answer first. Assuming what I'm citing and analyzing is all correct, this means that Huawei, which originally had a foundation built by communication technologies, has turned around to nearly become a semiconductor company, filling in a lot of the space that China's semiconductor industry is missing. This, of course, also indicates that China, in this complicated semiconductor industry, made a small counterattack and achieved some progress in the chip war. This rumor first came from a Reuters report on July 12th. The information was from a research organization, making it unlikely to be typical gossip. One of the key points is that Huawei is working with China's largest and most technologically advanced chip maker, SMIC, and may start mass production of its self-designed 5G chips this year at the earliest. At this point, we probably need to explain a bit about what self-designed means. As many people know that Huawei has an IC design company named HiSilicon under its wing. It was once among the top 10 IC design companies in the world, designing smartphone chips for Huawei, so why did it lose out? The answer is the two sanctions by the US. One is that TSMC can no longer take its orders, resulting in no firm can assist HiSilicon in manufacturing chips it designed. The second is the supply ban of EDA tools that are software it needs to design ICs. They are mainly provided by US-based Synopsys and Cadence and Germany-based Siemens EDA. These three companies together occupied 95% or even more of the share of the Chinese market. Losing its design tools, the firm's situation was like a chef seeing its cooking spoons, spatulas, and kitchen knives all taken away. Then his restaurant would, of course, need to shut down. The info also emphasized that the self-designed chips will support 5G, but that is not so surprising since Huawei has always had absolute leadership in the field of 5G, with its number of patents far higher than those of Ericsson and Nokia. This attracted the attention of the United States. But where is the design tool software from? Who dares to provide it to Huawei despite the US sanction? The answer is Huawei developed it in-house. Is that true? Well, it's not much of a secret. Huawei in late March 2023 made a public statement by Eric Xu, the rotating chairman at the time, talking about it. The details can be found easily on the internet. The point is that he said Huawei has basically realized domestically made EDA tools for above 14 nm nodes. The tools are expected to finish the full validation in 2023. It basically tells you that even if you don't sell me cooking spoons, spatulas, and kitchen knives, I will just build my own. Although we still can't do overly advanced technologies at this moment, we can just start from mature nodes, and we are now capable of doing 14 nanometer already. This is the message. Let us be aware that 14 nanometer is already not too far from the most advanced node existing now. However, this is only from the perspective of software design and not manufacturing. Furthermore, there is an issue existing here, which brought us to our second key point. In the Reuters report, Huawei and SMIC are working together to develop 7 nanometer technology instead of a 14 nanometer one. So does that mean Huawei's in-house made EDA software, or one developer by its Chinese EDA software designing partner, achieved a breakthrough in the last few months? Or is it that the old version of EDA software owned by Huawei was already able to work with 7 nanometer? That remains to be seen. So if any of the viewers have any further information, please feel free to provide it to us. Okay, so let's assume that HiSilicon really does have the tools to design 7-nanometer 5G chips. The next question then goes to whether SMIC can really manufacture them. We know that ZTE was included in the entity list by the US at the end of 2020, still not yet 3 years from today. At then, SMIC was actually able to make 7-nanometer chips, but if it is smartphones that need the chips, the volumes can go up to as high as tens of million, yes, several tens of million ICs. Before stepping down from its throne, Huawei's annual smartphone shipments was using the hundreds of million as the base unit and was developing a lot of models every year, with each needing to deliver the level of at least several tens of million units to qualify for the so-called mass production. Their corresponding yield rate also must be high, perhaps 80% or even above 90%, to be able to generate nice-looking financial reports like TSMC, which has a gross margin as high as 53%. So the mass production is a critical element. So can ZTE Mass produce 7-nanometer chips? ZTE is a listed company, reporting public financial statements regularly. What are the revenue ratios of ZTE's 14-nanometer and 7-nanometer chips revealed in the financial statements? Unfortunately, after ZTE was sanctioned, its financial statements no longer list its revenues by manufacturing process technology, so we have no way of knowing how many 14-nanometer, 10-nanometer, or 7-nanometer chips ZTE is producing at present, however, for the ratio in the past, as I recall. They were very low, at very small percentages, about 1 to 2%. In the middle of last year, some websites in the US reported to have found 7-nanometer made-in-China chips in products that were available in the China market. And though the information may be true, it only proved that SMIC can produce them, but not SMIC can mass-produce sub-14-nanometer chips. After the US Department of Commerce's most detailed and exhaustive export sanctions were issued on October 7, 2022, no matter if it is 14-nanometer or 7-nanometer chip manufacturing technology, they are all now restricted by the US. In other words, China will have to figure out ways to manufacture production equipment in-house first. In our last episode, we cited Mr. Richard Chang's saying and inferred that the 28 nanometer is the key that China is trying to conquer in terms of chip manufacturing equipment, with the lithography machines being the most important. For viewers who didn't watch the last episode, we highly recommend you to click on that video after this one. I'd also like to add one more point, an evident which I didn't mention in the last episode. According to the US Chips and Science Act and its implementing details, it was certain that manufacturing equipment for 28 nanometer chips is subject to the US restrictions. The Netherlands announced on June 30th that it will begin to ban the export of DUVs made by ASML to China on September 1st because of the act. In addition, Japan also announced on March 31st to control the export of 23 production equipment and raw materials in July. Looking into these trade bans, they are basically restricting technologies of 14-nanometer nodes and below, completely playing along with the US's sanctions issued on October 7th, 2022. If we put all these in simple words, the US has united Japan and the Netherlands in 2023 to block China from obtained advanced chips of made of 14-nanometer and below nodes, so it can't buy from outside of China, nor made them domestically. So back to today's topic, SMIC may be able to assist Huawei in mass-produce 7-nanometer chips, even if the chips are being manufactured with less advanced DUVs that they bought before. Originally, the DUVs could only produce chips with mature nodes, but now with the addition of the multiple exposure technique, they can now produce 7-nanometer chips, which is not actually easy because many raw materials that were originally imported from Japan may now become unavailable. So in this unfavorable situation, the production yield rate is likely to be less than satisfactory, the cost is likely to be higher, and the profit is unlikely to be good. The conclusion is that it is not going to be profitable. Then it leads us to the third key point today. Brand vendors like Apple and Samsung have already started using 3-nanometer chips. Why do Huawei still want to launch the so-called new smartphones, which are not the most advanced and probably not profitable? Why? My take on this is that to achieve progress in semiconductor manufacturing process, doing mass production is the only way to accumulate experience, and this learning curve has to be completed. If you don't do it because you're worried about not making profit, you're never going to make progress. You have to take the first step and then keep doing, and keep doing, so the yield rate can rise along with the learning curve, and profit will then slowly emerge. Huawei was most severely sanctioned by the US, and its business goal for the year before last was to survive, looked very moving and tragic. But the company so far still has around 200,000 employees, with over half of them being R&D personnel. Since Huawei did not drastically lay off workers due to the sharply declining performance, the company's deep technology foundation should still be there. But you can't live without an income, so it's better not to make a lot of money than have no income at all. To make a little money so it at least can survive is the key to why I believe it's important for Huawei to launch the new smartphones. Also, there is one more key point that I personally observed that other media have not mentioned much. Here is it. because smartphones are a consumer electronic product. They are easier to understand by consumers and receive more attention as consumers are using them every day. But in fact, Huawei's revenues from communication equipment and services were higher than those of smartphones. This is because in the communications equipment sector, Huawei's foundation is too advanced, and its market share was so high, their products even penetrated deeply into Europe and the US, leading to the US sounding the alarm. This is reasonable because the communication system has close relationship with the National Security Intelligence Unit, so close that the US could not just tolerate it. With that, Huawei may not only have breakthrough in the smartphone business, it is likely that the company also made some progress in communication equipment such as base stations, which is something we should keep watching. Well, that's all for this episode. We broadcast this program on Tuesday every 2 weeks and welcome your feedback. Please give us a like, share and forward this video, and also leave your comments to let us know your thoughts. I am Rocky. See you next time.